about to receive. May the Lord make you truly thankful.
Very
nice animals indeed, madam. And so very domestic.
So fond of their own, too, that it's really quite a pleasure, I'm sure.
Mrs. Corney, I must say that any animal that can live with you, madam, and not be fond of its own, must be an idiot, and don't deserve to live in it.
Oh, Mr. Bumble!
No use disguising facts, madam. An idiot. I would drown in myself with pleasure.
Then you're a very cruel man, and a very hard-hearted man besides.
Hard-hearted? Mrs. Corney, hard-hearted? Are you hard-hearted, Mrs. Corney?
Dear me, it's a very curious question coming from a single man. What can you want to know about this? Oh.
One boy, boy, sail. Come take a peep. Have you ever seen as nice a boy for
£3.
As a matter of fact, I was needing a boy.
Ah, good. It's settled. One colloquial parentis. £3, please.
If you don't mind, cash upon liking, Mr. Bumble. Cash upon liking. Mrs. Salisbury.
What is it?
Will you have the goodness to come here for a moment, my beloved?
Cheers.
I'm under-eating. That's your funeral.
That's your funeral. Peace and laws and earth and send you on the cloth like law. You can come back when you're buried underneath the sun.
We will not reduce our prices in your vices, you know. That's your funeral.
I don't think this song is funny.
That's your
You must know, your mother was a regular right down bottom.
What did you say?
A regular right down bottom. And it's a good thing she died too when she did, or she would have been transported, or even hung, from giving as like as not! Oh.
Drinking.
name.
Then the drinks are on the house. acquaintance, my dear. I hope I shall have the pleasure of your very intimate acquaintance.
Mr. Twist has come to London to seek his fortune.
Oh, and I hope we can do what we can to help you succeed in that. Are you hungry?
Starving.
Charlie?
Yes, sir?
Take off the sausages. Dodger?
Yeah.
Bring a chair nearer the fire for your new friend.
These sausages are moldy.
Oh, shut up and drink your gin. I see you're staring at the pocket handkerchiefs, my dear. There are quite a few of them. Just hang them out ready for the wash. That's all the wash.
Is this a laundry then, sir?
Well, I'm afraid the laundry would be a very nice thing indeed. But our line of business pays a little better, don't it, boys?
I'll say it does.
You see, Oliver, in this life, one thing counts, in the bank, large amounts. I'm afraid these don't grow on trees. You've got to pick a pocket or two. Got to pick a pocket or two.
Thank you.
houseman, ain't he?
Did he make those himself?
Yes, with his lily white hands.
Shut up, Charlie. And what have you got for me, my dear?
Those rocks.
Oh, very nice, too. Yellow and green. Oh, but you haven't embroidered them too well, Charlie. H or H. You're going to have to pick the initials up with the needle. I'm going to have one to do this, too. If you'd like to, my dear.
Yes, sir, if you'll teach me.
Oh, certainly. No charge. No charge whatsoever. Now, let's see. Can you see the corner of my pocket handkerchief here?
Yes, sir, I can just see the very tip of it.
Very good. Now, let's see if you can take it out without my feeling it, all right? Yes, like you've seen the Dodger and all the others do, all right? Like usual, all right, I promise.
£2 there. What else did he get me? Tables. Typical. Oh, come on, out, damn sport. Out, Pavilion, come on. No, you're just mine. Just mine. Only mine, my friend. Let's see, let me find your box. Yep, go in here and play among the others. Yep, play with all the other goodies in there. Very good, okay. Now, hard to get a pocket or two. Oh, is you glad to pick a pocket or two?
I never tire of it. Lean this man.
Dixie and Bex. Oh, yes, for all ladies and gentlemen around here are all quality.
Don't you pay them no mind, Oliver, just because you've got manners and they ain't. You lot wouldn't know quality if you saw it. Have you seen the way them quality gentlemen treats their ladies?
Well, of course I have.
Shall we show them how it's done?
Definitely.
So how's it go then, Dodger? It's all bowing and that's off then.
Don't let your petticoats dangle in the mud, my darling.
And all the last.
All the last.
No, all the last.
Now give us a free show on the stage, Nancy.
Thank you.
Stop that boy, my pocket's been picked.
Thank you. 19 Cheapstone Gardens, Bloomsbury. I run all the way.
Why didn't you look after him? You were supposed to look after him. You were supposed to bring him back with you.
Who?
One of us, Bill, a new boy. He went on his first job today with Dodger. I'm afraid he might say something which will get us into trouble.
Well, then that's very likely you're blown upon, Fagin.
And you see, my dear, if the game was up with us, you might be up for a good many more. And it would come out rather worse for you than it would for me, my dear.
Why, you old... Somebody must find out what's been done or said. If he hasn't talked already, we still might be able to get him back without suspicion. We'll nab him the very moment he dares to step out of the house. Now, who's going to go?
I suppose it ought to be me.
Oh, you shut your trap, Dodger. You've caused enough trouble. Why, Nancy, you're so good with the boy.
Don't go trying it on with me, Fagin.
And just what do you mean by that?
What I say, Bill.
You're the very thing, Nancy. Why? The very person for the job. Nobody up that way knows anything about you.
If I don't want you, either, it's rather more no than yes with me. I'm not Gary. Why can't you leave the boy where he is? He won't do no harm. Why can't you leave the boy while I get a chance of a decent life?
You'll go get him back, my girl, or else you'll feel my hands upon your throat!
Here. Bill.
Now, he's not going to say nothing. He's not going to say, but it could turn out so bad, Nancy. I mean, think what it would mean for all of us. Think what it means for your Bill. You mean the gallows, Nancy, the gallows. You don't want your Bill to go to the gallows, do you? Not your Bill.
She'll go, Fagin.
Oh, she won't, Fagin. Don't think it.
Oh, yes, she will, Fagin. Go on, get out.
Go home, Betty.
Come along, Dodger.
Love them so. I won't be true.
May I stay here always, sir?
If you wish, dear boy, if you wish. Is the doctor come to see you?
Well, he certainly does look better. But you're still not sleeping well, are you?
Oh, no, sir. I sleep very well.
Bad dreams, though, I've no doubt. Nightmares, eh?
No, sir, I don't have dreams.
You're not hungry, are you?
No, doctor.
Not hungry. Not thirsty, are you? If that boy is thirsty, I'll eat my head.
Yes, I am rather thirsty.
Thought so. It's quite natural he should be a little thirsty. You may give him a little tea, Miss Bedwin.
Oh, yes, doctor.
May I get up now, sir?
Say, I think you may, and take a little fresh air. Make sure that he doesn't get too warm, Miss Bedwin, but be careful he doesn't stay too cold.
Oh, certainly, doctor.
You'll be glad to be up again, Mother.
Shall I wear these?
You can't wear your old clothes, that's for certain, because I threw them in a furnace. So hurry up.
He's a fine-looking boy, don't you think, Grimlick?
I can't say. I only know two types of boys. Mealy boys and beef-faced boys.
Well, which is all about?
Mealy, where does he come from?
I have the faintest idea. He was arrested for stealing my pocket handkerchief. When the shopkeeper told what had actually happened and the magistrate released him, I brought him here to make what amends I could. But I find myself strangely attached to him.
He's deceiving you, my good friend. He has had a fever. What of that? Fevers are not peculiar to good people, are they? But bad people have fevers sometimes, don't they? He has stolen your pocket handkerchief and he will steal some more. What do you know of him? Nothing.
No. Only that he's an orphan. And yet, it's strange. There's something in the boy's face. I can't explain it, but somewhere I've seen it before. Somewhere a long time ago.
Oh, stuff and nonsense. You're imagining things.
Yes, what is it?
Someone's arrived to see you here, sir.
What does he want?
The boy. What do you have about books?
Your books from the bookseller, sir.
Oh, yes, thank you. Now here's some. Hey, wait. Hey, come back. Oh, really, really, really. And I did particularly want some books to go back to.
Should
you
be wearing
that?
Yes,
please. Why not send Oliver?
Yes, sir, please, I will send them for you.
If you wish, good boy, if you wish. Now here's what I want you to do. I want you to go to Mr. Chester's and take these books. Tell him you've come to pay the £4.10 I owe you. That is £5. No need to hurry, but I do expect you back in 10 minutes. It's just down the road.
She's a very pretty lady, isn't she, sir?
Yes, it's a portrait of my daughter Agnes.
I will return the book for you, sir.
Yes, you do that.
Ha! He's deceiving you. You don't really expect him to come back, do you? With a new suit of clothes on his back and a £5 note in his pocket. Mr. Brownlow, if he comes back, I'll eat my head.
Dr. Grimwick, look at the portrait. Don't you see an extraordinary resemblance between Oliver and the daughter of Agnes?
Can't say I do.
Well, in 10 minutes' time, Dr. Grimwick, when the boy returns, I think you will.
Yes, Mr. Brownlow, 10 minutes!
Touch the sky, everything's clear. Clear the sky.
gifts go? From his parents, who are hard-working, respectable people. And he went and joined a set of thieves and bad characters. He nearly killed his mother and father. Make him come home.
Come on home.
I won't. I got no sister. Got no father. Got no mother, neither.
Jarvis, listen to him.
There, tell him to let me go.
See, he knows his little sister. He can't hide that.
What the devil is this? Young Oliver, come home, you young dog. Your poor mother is, she's dying. Come home. And what are these books?
They're Mr. Brownlow's.
So you've been stealing again, have you? Why, he's nothing but a thief and a vagabond. A thief and a vagabond. Come on home, you young scoundrel. Go home. Shut your mouth.
It's a fun.
Now I'd be the first one to say that I wasn't a saint. I'm finding it hardly really as black as they paint.
Are you going to sit there snoring all day?
laugh or cry as the humor strikes me. Such being my prerogative.
Your prerogative.
I said the word, madam. The prerogative of a man is to command.
Oh, and what's the prerogative of a woman in the name of goodness?
To obey, madam, to obey. Your late husband should have taught you that. But then if he did, perhaps he'd be alive today, and I wish he was, poor man.
Oh, you hard-hearted brute!
Oh, here we go.
Give him his due.
not my wife.
You mean that when he left your workhouse, he went to an undertaker's?
Yes, Mr. Sowerberry, the undertaker, took Oliver from us for £3.
You mean you sold him like an animal?
Well, it was Mrs. Bumble who authorized the sale.
You just lose your job, that's all.
Indeed it will reflect on you. And your behavior, madam, was shameful.
Oh,
leave my house.
How dare you speak so to me, sir?
I came here to help you.
You came here in the hopes of profiting from your own greed and dishonesty.
Well, as to that, sir, should you decide the locket never properly belonged to my dear wife?
Shut up, you old fool!
Here, £10. Take it. And consider yourself fortunate that you don't end up in the hands of the law. Mrs. Bedwin, show these ghastly people.
Oh, gladly, sir. We know the way out. Thank you very much.
I hope this unfortunate little circumstance will not deprive me of my parochial office.
Indeed it will, and you may think yourself well off besides.
But it was all Mrs. Bumble. She would do it.
That is no excuse. Well, you were present on the occasion when the boy was sold, and you, sir, are the more guilty of the two in the eyes of the law. For the law supposes that your wife acts under your direction.
Well, if the law supposes that, then the law's an ass. And if that's the eye of the law, then the law must be a bachelor. And the worst I wish the law is that his eye may be opened by experience. By experience!
Oh, there's a young lady inquiring for you, sir.
Mrs. Bedwin, take a look at this miniature. Can you see who it is?
Why, it's Agnes, sir.
Yes, my daughter Agnes. She must have made her way to the workhouse where she had the child.
Oh, I wish she had told us.
Mrs. Bedwin, who is this?
She's inquiring about the boy.
Have you news of Oliver?
He's in danger. In bad company. He was dragged off the day you sent him out with those books.
By who?
Me? Someone else.
Where can I find him? Who is this person you speak of? Take me to him.
I shouldn't have said that.
Would you like to sit down?
Yes, yes. Now come sit down. You want to help the boy, don't you? What else are you here?
I do want to help, but...
Then at least tell me where I can find him.
Hi. But I'll bring him to you. Not here, it's too far.
Where?
The bridge. London Bridge, tonight at midnight. But you've got to come alone. Please promise me you'll come on your own. You want to see Olive again, you've got to believe me.
Very well. Fuck.
Thank God.
Wait! Has the boy been hurt? Ill-treated? If so...
Pat, say no more. He'll kill me as it is if he knows where I've been.
I understand, my dear.
Who is this man? Perhaps we can...
No, we can't.
But a man who wants to murder you?
Yeah. But he's mine. And I'm his. I've got to go back. I want to go back.
Bye.
Can somebody change? It's possible. Pain is strange, but it's possible. All my dearest companions and treasures I've left them behind. I'll turn a leaf over and who can tell what I may find. Hello, young man.